would keep you there.
You would keep me what? Drowning?
So that no, I would keep you so we float together. I would never let you sink.
It fucking makes me cry every time she fucking talks.
Titanic's the second worst captain steering a ship I've ever. They get it too.
Fuck yeah.
Jump straight ahead. Plow through it.
Let's go to the telegraph.
And it's so much fun to do. I love playing the straight guy co-host to his fucking insane character. But yeah, we've done these live shows and they're really a lot of fun. And he's just he's a great guy.
There he is. There he is.
The fucking outfit. Oh my God.
It's so ridiculous. He's got to stay in. Look at those pants.
Yeah, that is hilarious.
Dude, the place is like packed and. It's crazy.
What are you guys reading? What are the notes?
Oh, he wanted us to. He wrote like a almost a play, but it's all just kissing Chip's ass and how wonderful Chip is and how thankful we are to be there. Like it's so goddamn funny. I love it. He's brilliant, man. He's just a great guy and very fucking funny. I knew from the first. I think that. Also, kind of, I'm not blaming Jimmy or anything, but I think that helped to kind of break up the ONA show in time. I think Opie started resenting a little bit of that camaraderie that me and Jimmy were having. Me and Jimmy kind of slowly started pulling away and doing our own thing. Like it was, and the humor is, you know, the more twisted, the better. I love sick humor. He does too. And we laugh. We did a whole bit on like Lacey Peterson and Scott Peterson, the murder. Yeah. And you would think like, obviously he murdered his pregnant wife and dumped her in the ocean. What could possibly be funny about that? Well, people wrote tribute songs. Well, this guy wrote a tribute song to her. And another one of these self-centered assholes that thought he was going to go viral by making a tribute song. And we started changing the words to the song to make it just horrible, involving seaweed and things. Like. So it was terrible. But me and Jim are literally crying, laughing. Oh. And Opie's just kind of sitting there, like not really able to jump in or not kind of getting why we're laughing at this sick shit. So it kind of pushed us further apart at that point. Yeah. We both, as people, changed over the course of... the 20 years we worked together, 20 fucking years with anybody, dude, is nuts. You get a girl that suck your dick every day for 20 years, you're going to be like, oh, fuck, stop sucking my dick. But now it's think it's Opie across from me, you know.
Yeah.
So you're going to get on each other's nerves. And I'm not innocent in the whole thing either. But I'm a lot more laid back. Like I knew what real work was. I worked for fucking living. I did heating and air conditioning installation, and it was freezing cold in the winter and boiling hot in the summer. And when I got that first gig in radio, because of Opie, and I'll always thank him for that, I knew what it was like to work, and I didn't want to fuck that up. So I plastered a smile on my face at every turn and did the show 4 hours a day. Everyone has someone at work that they don't get along with. You don't leave. You don't fucking, you know, you just deal with it. And that's 8 hours. I had another 20 hours of the day that didn't involve Greg Opie Hughes. So I could deal with it. He was more like he had to express himself a little more, which, you know, I guess is healthy in a way. But I didn't need to. So I didn't text him. I didn't call him. We got in an argument once and he goes, dude, you never even been to my house. And I go, all right. Get everyone from the show in here. Jim, have I ever been to the house? Nope. Travis, no. Sam, no. E-Rock, no. I've never been to anyone's house.
Let me tell you something right now.
Yeah.
That's something a chick would say.
I know.
Have you ever been to my house?
Dude, it's exactly that.
You've never even been to my house.
Type of relationship.
What does that mean?
What does it even mean?
I've never been to Africa. What the fuck are you saying?
I've never been to Spain.
What does that have to do with anything that we... If, if you had a problem with me not coming to your house, why didn't you ask me to come to your house?
Yeah.
Like, is there, like, you asking me every day and I'm saying no every
day? And I'm saying no, right, right.
What's going on?
It was always something like that. And believe me, I'm not going to sit here and shit on the guy. My show's for that. I'm not going to... I'm not going to shit on the guy, but there were definitely personality quirks that I guess we both had. But there was something like, if I would party all the time, and you know, I had to be there at 6 a.m. and I'm driving from Roslyn, Long Island, to New York City. It's 25, 30 miles of just fucked traffic every day.
How long did it take you to get there?
It could be 35 minutes. It could be an hour and a half. Based on if someone's pulled over on the side of the road, some asshole crashes in Queens, whatever it was a shit drive every day.
And you had to be there at 6, right?
6 o'clock the show started.
And so even at 6, there'd be that kind of traffic?
Yeah, yeah. It wasn't as bad as it got at like 7 or 8, but you never really knew.
Right.
It could. I was never late, but there were times I'd come in at 5 after. 8 after 6 was pretty much as late as I would be. It was never more than that. But he would go, like, he never had to say anything. Like, the music starts, there's a little bumper at the beginning. And by the time it starts, I'd sit down. And he, on mic, would go, well, I guess there was traffic. Anthony just getting in. And now the bosses are listening. And it just wasn't necessary to do that. You know, it kind of, I was like,
he wanted something you gotta to be talk about.
Guys don't do that. Guys don't do that to each other. You fucking sit down, don't say a word. No one would know I'm late, you know? And that's what happened. And there were instances like that all the time. It's all in my book, Permanently Suspended.
Is that book out now?
It's out now.
Whoa.
Yeah. Borders, Barnes & Noble.
Green room. I think we have a copy in the green room.
Ah, yes. Very good. Mm. But
it's at my house. It's in my house.
I talk a lot about obviously the relationship and with Opie and how it kind of slowly came apart at the seams. I think toward the end, he just had it. He didn't want to do a show with me anymore. I don't think he wanted to do a show with Jimmy either. That didn't last long, and I knew it wasn't going to last long. I was the buffer between the two of them.
That ended bad.
It really did. really did.
Like, if you talk to Jimmy about it, like,
yeah, yeah,
like he doesn't express that kind of,
no,
yeah,
no, he doesn't. Like, Jimmy's a very loyalty driven guy. Yeah. Like he takes that very seriously, and if he feels somebody's fucking with him, he really gets pissed. Usually, it can get talked out and everything's cool after a little while, but this one, oof, This is bad.
It didn't work. Yeah.
But, no.
I think, honestly, the way you guys interacted with each other, what he was good for was sort of directing the whole thing.
Right.
That's the impression that I got how many times did I do the show? Dozens, right?
Yeah, yeah.
I don't know how many times I did it.
Absolutely.
But I always felt like what he did really well was, like, sort of guide things. Like, sit back more. Let you guys be funny, but guide, like, figure out, like, maybe we need more of this, maybe we need more of that.
Yeah.
And there was real value to that.
Absolutely. But do you think that's fun when you go out and do an appearance and everyone's clamoring about a bit that me and Jimmy did or something?
For him,
and,
you mean.
And, yeah. And yeah. He's sitting there going, like, well, I pushed a button and I drove the ship and I, you know, went to spots. And
if he knew... It's funny because, like, yeah, you're not going to be appreciated
right.
as much, but it's like a guy who is good at defense, but he doesn't score a lot of points.
Yeah, yeah,
yeah. You're not going to be LeBron James.
It's necessary.
The guys who score the points, though, are the ones who everybody wants to talk to. You know?
Yeah. You ever see? I think of Opie like. You ever see The Prestige? The movie The Prestige, with the two magicians.
No,
it's a good movie. It's a good movie, but at one point, because he has to use a body double, the actual magician has to drop below the stage, and the body double comes out and gets all the applause, and he's under the stage. The real guy that did the whole act is under the stage, and he shuts his eyes and puts his arms out, like trying to enjoy the adulation from the fans, but ooh, it's not even him getting it. And I think that kind of mindset was there. There's, and then resentment starts bubbling up, and you start doing things like saying, Anthony just got in. You hold things over people's heads. The contract negotiations were a nightmare every time. And Opie always wanted a one-year deal. I'm like, what the fuck are you doing? Let's sign for 10 years. Who gives a shit? You know, if they want to fire you, they're going to fire you anyway, right, contract or not. But let's lock them in. So if something happens, at least we have a settlement portion. We could take half the what they owe us for 5 years, whatever it is. Not one-year deal. That's all I want. Because he always had this delusion of grandeur. Like there was always something better waiting for us to grab up. And it's like the truth of the matter was the glory years of the ONA show were gone.